Now, perhaps you noticed that the animations came up with a different name to as they appear here. And changing this so they all have the different name is fairly simple. The first thing you'll need is some kind of bulk file renaming thing. Here we use the bulk rename utility. Simply select all of the files and in the prefix add barn underscore. And now that will add barn underscore to every single SMD file here. And the SMD file is what contains the information for how the animation works. And click rename. And now they're all changed here. Secondly, we need to go to the QC file located here, which, as we can see, contains a reference to all of the animations existing here as SMD files. This time what we do in the Notepad++, Control F for the Find window, and Replace. And you want to replace anything that begins sequence with a space and a quotation mark to have sequence barn underscore. And replace all. And this has now given every single reference to an animation a prefix of barn so that they align with the new names here. Last little thing that has to be changed is the secondary reference giving the exact file location. What we do this time is select whatever is directly before the original file name, which will depend on the name of the model itself, and copy this into the replace box and give it a barn underscore addition, replacing all once again, leaving them all now with a barn underscore prefix, keeping them fully linked up with their name as they appear here. We didn't mention this straight away because it's kind of an optional feature. It will work either way, isn't exactly necessary, but I wanted to mention how easily it can be modified. Since, of course, you don't have to just give it a prefix, you can change the name entirely if you want to, so long as the name you give it here and the references are identical, it will function properly. Let's say for a bit of additional customization, you would like to use the Tint function. Now, inside of the Source Filmmaker, you have the ability to right click on the model and set a color tint. This allows you to change the color of how the model looks like, to some extent at least. But let's say you want to control which parts you change the color and which parts you do not change the color. To do that, you need to go back into the material editor, as we saw earlier. Of course, it would take some time to open all of these materials at once. So what you can simply do is, in the asset browser, right click on the model you've made and click to open 27 related files in the material editor. Say yes, because it's going to ask you, because you're opening quite a few. And you tell it that yes, you do want to. It'll take a little bit of time, but pretty soon it's going to figure out what it's doing. And here we have the materials have now opened. Now what all of these have is a tint mask. And a tint mask appears under color in the form of an alpha channel. An alpha being from 1 to 0, from black to white, where black is 0% change and white is 100% change, with these various gray values interpolating between 1 and 0. So what you can easily do is adjust the tints level of each of these materials so that only the specific parts of the model, in this case, the sleeves around here and the trousers, are able to be changed by the tint mask feature we just showed you in SFM. So, for instance, here we have the helmet, specifically the inner side of the helmet, which should not be affected. We have the outer side of the helmet, this should also not be affected. So we'll add a tint mask and a color and take this down to zero. We now have a more selective tint mask. As you can see, it's ignoring the tint on the gun and on the hands and on the face, and only changing the colors on the materials of the body. But we don't want to change the tint of the vest or the straps along the boots or the tie here. But to change this, the process we need to do is to open up these individual materials, the ones which specifically need to have partially tinted and partially not tinted, and open them inside of a material editor. Of course, you can't open these themselves in a material editor. So what you can do is copy the path where the material is kept. Although I have to mention that the material might not always be kept here. In this case, though, it is. And find the material itself. The X front bot 1. Now we can open this TGA inside of GIMP. And then the process goes to create a new folder. Select the area which we want the tint to be applied to. And fill it up with white. Boom. Invert the selection and fill the other half with black. And that's the process. We're actually going to export this with the underscore of mask, since that's what it's looking for specifically. And we have here the mask layer, which we now open. And if we save the material, go back to the SFM we have open back here. And we see now the boots are unchanged by the tint mask. Now I guess we can quickly do the rest of these. And here we have the model now correctly masked. There's a few places where there could be some improvement. For instance, there's small issues around the boots here, where the materials cross over. But for the most part, and for an explanation of what this does and how it works, this is good enough for the means of this tutorial. And you're now easily able to change the overall appearance of Barney, including the color of his helmet, giving you the ability to quickly duplicate and have copies of the same model in your scene without them appearing like they are simply clones of the same thing. Perhaps one of the most useful additions, which has hitherto been unmentioned by these tutorial videos, at least in the capacity of animations such as Inlet performs, is the ability to have the model create an IK rig. An IK rig gives you the ability to, well, usually animation, or the rigs that you animate with are set up like this. You align the bones, you do whatever you need to do. It's a slow and usually unintuitive process, but you have the ability to apply a rig to the model, allowing you to directly select arms, specifically feet and hands, and adjust the elbows and knees in a far more intuitive way. You have actually the ability to do this very easily with an imported model. And the process of doing that simply requires you to rename the bones to suit the naming convention of the default model. Nothing else more fancy has to be done. Let's attach the rig so we can see the original bones that this model comes with, the Half-Life Alyx default citizen. And we head back over to the model dock, as we no doubt came to fall in love with last time we were here. Going to ads, we can find a rename bone option. Doing this, we can take the original name of the bones as shown on the skeleton selection down here. Let's bring this out a bit more and open it up for all to see. Leg, right leg. In the left side, underneath rename bone, let's make a few copies since we'll be needing them. We just have to put the names over here and replace them with the naming convention of the Half-Life Alyx model. So for instance, the pelvis, the root, its current name being BIP01_pelvis, gets simply renamed to pelvis. Let's check it's working, compile the model. Let's redelete these so it will let us compile. And check back in source. Now this hasn't updated, but it usually won't instantly update names like this without reloading the model. And perhaps pelvis. You see, the name is updated. So now, what do we have? Well, you'll notice, if we go and import another copy of HL1 Barney, open him up, you'll see straight away that while the old Barney has only dots for the bones, this Barney has an actual bone structure, since Source 2 now recognizes it as having the bone structure the same as the default rig inside of Source 2. This also means that we are able to right-click on the model and, just like for the citizen earlier, auto-attach rigs. And now you see Barney is able to be controlled by means of manipulating the control points of the hands and the feet, the knees, in a way that's easier to mess around with and get used to than simply adjusting the bones, such as in this case. Now, one thing I should mention, well, two things really. One is that you can, of course, rename the bones inside of Blender. And when you rename them in Blender and re-import the model, it will have the correct naming convention there too. But the only problem there is the bones inside of the SMD, the one you import into Blender, are looking for bones with these names. So if you rename the bones in Blender and then import the animations, it won't recognize which bone is which, and the animations won't work. So I'd suggest just changing the bones inside of S2FM, the Source 2 model doc. Since then, you preserve the original bone names, only renamed with a modifier, and the animations still work. The other thing I would mention is that for some models, you will receive an error. Now this error is created when the lower legs are too much in a straight line with the upper legs, or if the lower arm is too much in line with the upper arm. And the issue this causes is that the Source engine doesn't know which way is forwards and which way is backwards. You see, it's worked for the arms, but it hasn't worked for the legs. All you need to do for this is to select the lower legs, and just rotate them forward slightly, and it will then understand, well, the bend is going this way, so this way must be the way the knee is pointed. We detach the rig, reattach it, and you'll see we now have a working IK for the scientist as well. I should also mention that the conversion of the names is not a one-to-one scale. There are not the same number of spine bones, there are not the same number of other bones. And you might have noticed in the sped up preview earlier, I made a few mistakes. So this system does take some trial and error to get perfected. And even then, maybe it won't work perfectly. What you can do if you really need to, is inside of Blender, you can mess around with the weight painting. But I'll leave you to find your own tutorial on rig weight painting. And as you can see, the inconsistent number of bones has caused certain bones to become missing. What have we been able to achieve with the lessons today? Well, we've figured out how we can change the names of the animations to suit whatever requirements you would have. We've given the ability to move certain parts, certain bones you wouldn't usually be able to move by way of facial flexors, or morphs as they're commonly known in Source 2. And we've gained the ability to change the color of specific parts of a model to suit our own requirements. Alongside that, we've seen how we can change the name of the bones to get the IK working. Hopefully you've learned something today. If you haven't, you should have paid more attention. For more information, you can consult your local information office at the Discord.